Welcome to Shiloh. Awesome to have you here this morning. Was watching the countdown and watching the snow fall and thinking about the rain outside. And don't you just wish that was all snow? I usually get mixed reviews when we talk about having a lot of snow. This is the fourth Sunday of Advent, our final Sunday morning together before Christmas. So let me say from our family to yours, Merry Christmas. We love you and appreciate all of you so very much. At the end of the music portion of the service, as always, the children will be dismissed and go to their service in the fellowship hall. And please be reminded that the fellowship hall doors are for Shiloh kids and their families only. Appreciate that so very much. Also, thank you to everyone who sponsored one of these beautiful poinsettias for men's ministry. They appreciate that so very much. Today, if you haven't picked up your Christmas cards, they're on the table here to my right. And you can look through those and see if your family has a stack of Christmas cards. And tonight we have a very special service. Well, they're all special. Why do we say that? It's going to be a special service. They're all special services. But tonight we're going to have some carols, a scripture reading, and communion. And I thought, well, you can't sing all the carols in one night, right? I mean, well, I guess we could. We'd be here a long time. But you'll obviously get here and there'll be a carol or a Christmas song or two that'll be your favorite that we might miss. So I've asked for a group called Johnny and Chachi. They're going to join us and they're going to give us the 25 Christmas songs for us to hear this morning. Are you up for that? You don't seem sure. They're going to do it in 2 minutes though, so we'll be good.
And now, a very special Johnny and Chachi Christmas medley.
Yeah, she's quiet. Hi, I'm Johnny, and this is Chachi, and Merry Christmas.
You know, people all over the world celebrate the birth of our Savior on December 25th.
And there are hundreds, if not thousands, of very popular Christmas songs. And we wanted to sing 25 Christmas songs in under 2 minutes. We even have a counter here.
I'm not even sure we can do that.
No, I think we can. Let's give it a go.
Just hear those sleigh bells ringing, jing, jing, jingling, deck the halls with boughs of holly, joy to the world. It's beginning to look a lot like Grandma got run over by a good King Wenceslas lost. Hark how the bells, sweet silver bells, all sing the sheep bells, a wee Christmas is here, bringing good cheer to young and old. On Christmas Day, on Christmas Day, was my cheer supposed to be? A partridge in a pear, they told me. It came upon the midnight clear. And do you hear what I hear?
Do you hear voices in your head too?
No. What?
In the meadow, we can build a frosty the snowman.
On the house top, click.
Chimney with jolly old St. Nicholas. Lean your ear this way.
Johnny wants a pair of skates.
Rudolph the red-nosed reindeer of a white shiny
Christmas.
It's Christmas time in the city.
Let it snow, let it snow.
Have a holly jolly Christmas.
Jingle bells, jingle bells.
It's the best time of the year. We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas and a one horse open sleigh.
Feliz Navidad.
Merry Christmas.
Yeah, Merry Christmas.
There you go, 26 in 2 minutes. You think you could beat that, Mr. Larry?
I can match it.
He can match it. I hear it. It's here we're gonna go. You told me to tell you if it got loud. That was loud. All right. It is great to have you here this morning, and as we come and worship and laugh, isn't it great to have fun at church? To laugh and share with our friends and family. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer at this time. Will you stand with me? It's an opportunity for us to share our needs, not just with God. He already knows before we show up, but with each other. In the bulletin, there's a list of needs, and people requested that we pray for them, and hopefully that you're doing that throughout the week. But are you here this morning, and you would have a need this morning that you would like to share with the congregation? And will you look around and pray for one another this morning and throughout the week? Will you do that? Jesus, we love you, and we thank you. Lord, we thank you for the fun of Christmas. We thank you for all the laughter and the joy. We thank you that we can come to church and just laugh and have a good time, but also know that the real reason for Christmas is that you came as a baby. That Christmas is really just the beginning of Easter, and we give you praise and glory for that. We love you. You are such a good God. So creative in the ways that you minister to us, so creative in the ways that you speak to us. And so we ask you this morning that you would minister to us, meet our needs, reach down and touch us in our hearts, or that you would speak to us this morning. Encourage us. Help us as we worship you to connect with you. Be with the children as they're in Shiloh Kids and in the nursery. And we just give you praise and glory because you are such an amazing and good God. Isn't it good to be in the house of the Lord today? Can you just go ahead and give the Lord a hand of praise for the privilege to be here? Amen? We certainly missed being together last week, and we are so grateful to be able to be back together. We were together by being online, but to be back in person, we're certainly grateful for that. And so on this last Sunday before Christmas 2020, we were talking about in our Sunday school class as we viewed a video and said we would discuss it in 2 weeks. And I told my wife, I said, that means we'll talk about it next year. Do you realize in 2 weeks when we're back, it'll be next year? Can you believe that? I'm sort of ready for 2021. How about you? Amen? But today, there is one that we want to sing about that changes not. It doesn't matter with the passing of years. How many of you know God is always God? And that's what the songwriter was trying to tell us, that he is God forever. How many of you know that he is forever God? This is a good song to put your hands together if you'd like to, and lift your voice and lift your heart and sing it out. Come on, here we go, sing it.
Give thanks to the Lord.
Thank you. position, baby, Stephen.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Good morning. Nasty morning, but it's good to be in the house of the Lord.
Amen.
Sing hallelujah to our God.
Jesus Christ and how good He has been in my life. I look back and I cannot find one thing of His grace, one example of His mercy that I deserved. Not one. But because He chose, please hear me, because He chose to set His love upon me and upon you. That is why, and the only reason why, you and I have experienced the goodness of God. Are you grateful for the goodness of God? Oh, I am. That's what this song talks about. It really just gives you opportunity to say thank you and that you love Him for that goodness. Come on, sing it with us. Here we go.
I love you, Lord.
thank you so much for joining us in songs of worship, songs of the season, and worship as well. We're grateful for our special today, grateful for everyone that works in all the different areas of the church. So our young people are headed over now for our Shiloh Kids. We praise the Lord for that ministry and thank the Lord for that ministry. Appreciate all those that work so tirelessly in that to provide that opportunity for our young people to be able to participate. Well, today, Brother Larry is going to light our candles for us. And if you'll note today, we'll be lighting four candles because this is the fourth Sunday of Advent that we're celebrating. Now, tonight, in our special service that we're having, as Pastor Jeff said, they're all really special, but in our extra service, I guess we'll call it, as far as extra in-person service tonight, we'll light our fifth candle and tonight to just kind of close out this celebration of Advent with the lighting of candles. The fourth candle that we light today is representative of love in the Advent season. The fourth candle is representative of love. And that's that tall pink candle that he has lit today, representing love. Is anybody grateful for that love that we've just sung about, that mercy, that grace? Well, I am. And I would hope that you are as well and would believe that you are. That is part of the reason that you are here today. A lot of people talk about reasons why to go to church. To me, one of the reasons is to just show him that I love him. I think that's a pretty good reason, amen? I love to be together in the house of the Lord. Today, we are reading from Scripture in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 1. And we want to read verses 18 through 25, and you're hearing for our text today. The Gospel of Matthew, chapter 1, verses 18 through 25. For our text verses today. Please come back and be with us tonight. As Brother Jeff has already said, we're going to have a few Christmas songs that we're going to sing together. Then we'll have some brief reading of Scripture, just a brief thought, and then we'll close with our December communion being tonight at the close of this special service. So please keep that in mind. Also, next Sunday, remember, we're scheduled to have just the 10 a.m. service only. And we're going to try to have you out here probably in a more timely manner than we sometimes do. And so please plan to be back with us next Sunday, the good Lord willing, on that 27th. And we look forward to that. The Gospel of Matthew chapter 1, verse 18 through 25, the word of the Lord declares this unto us. Now the birth of Jesus was as follows. After his mother Mary was betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Spirit. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not wanting to make her a public example, was minded to put her away secretly. But while he thought about these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take to you Mary your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. And she will bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. So all this was done, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, saying, Behold, the virgin shall be with child and bear a son. They shall call his name Emmanuel, which is translated God with us. Then Joseph, being aroused from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord commanded him, and took to him his wife, and did not know her till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus. I want to speak to you today. We're talking about focusing on love, the fourth Sunday of Advent season. We're talking about, especially thinking about love. And today, I want to speak to you about Joseph's love. Joseph's love, the Joseph from the Christmas story. Will you pray with us? Father, thank you for the privilege to look into your word. We ask that you would just anoint us now. Bless the reading of your word to our hearing. May it be profitable in our lives, in every area of our life. And God, I pray that you would just speak to all of our hearts over these next few moments in a special way. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Thinking about the thought today of Joseph's love. And I've said already today we are concluding as far as our Sunday morning celebrating of Advent for this Advent season 2020. On the first Sunday of Advent, if you would remember, we spoke to you about the wonderful hope of Isaiah. And as much as any time in the world today, people need hope. Can I get an amen? As much as any time in the world today, people need hope. And the hope that they need is the same hope that that we spoke about in that wonderful hope of Isaiah. On the second Sunday, we spoke about the angels' plea for peace. Do we not need to see some peace in so many areas of our country and our world today? True peace that can only come through the same one that the angels made their announcement about, and that is through the Lord Jesus Christ. And then on the third Sunday, we had to do it virtually, but on the third Sunday, we spoke to you online on the shepherd's joy. And we also, today's world, needs that joy that we spoke about in that particular sermon. And then today, our fourth Sunday, as we've said, the last AM part of our Advent season of worship, as far as celebrating the Advent, we want to speak to you today on what we're calling Joseph's love. I would have to think that perhaps you would agree with me that there is truly no story that would be found any more amazing than the Christmas story. It is still one of the most amazing stories ever known to man. And one of the most amazing characters in this story is not sometimes given as much billing, but is a man named Joseph. And I told you in one of the earlier series sermons that we were not going to talk. We read some scripture about him. We talked about his obedience, but we said we would deal a little more extensively with him later. And that's today that we want to try to do that for a few moments. Joseph, if you think about it, he's almost seen as almost one of the silent characters of the Christmas story. But yet, though he's seen as sometimes one of the silent characters of the Christmas story, yet the truth of the fact is what he did through his actions speaks volumes. What he did through his actions speaks volumes. And it is in Joseph that we can truly see an amazing love. So for just a few moments today, I want you to think about something that perhaps you've not heard as much about, and that is this. How amazing is it that the man would step into the role of his earthly father, though he was not his father, because we know who his father is. How amazing it is that the man who would fulfill his obligation to his betrothed, the man who would be alongside of his wife, that would raise up in that childhood days and serve as that earthly father to the man who really had a heavenly father, how amazing is it that he could be a type and shadow and show in type and shadow the love of the very Savior's love that has been shown to you and I. Well, let me say that again. It is amazing that Joseph could be used of God to be a type and shadow and to show forth a glimpse of that love that the Savior would show the entire world. What about this guy named Joseph? And what is it that we see in him that would make us take this last in this series and talk about Joseph's love? Well, first of all, I want you today for a few moments, I want you to help me, and I want you to see in Joseph that we can see an amazing love for God. I want you to see that in Joseph, we can see an amazing love for God. And I want to ask you this question right here. Can people see the love of God in you and me? Can people see the love of God in you and in me? Now you might say, oh preacher, I tell people about Jesus all the time. Oh, I'm always telling people about Jesus loves them. I didn't ask you what you said. I didn't ask you about what I was saying. I said, can people see the love of God in you and in me? Can I be honest? Sometimes we preachers can be some, now I'm not really pushing for an amen here, but sometimes we preachers can be some of the most wordy people in the world. And y'all may talk about us preachers for being wordy, but sometimes y'all can be just as wordy. As a matter of fact, I run into one or two that are even more wordy than I am, if that's possible, and it is. I know it's a stretch, but it's possible. Sometimes, we in the church, we have been better at telling people about the love of God than we have been at showing the world the love of God. Now, we're not supposed to stop telling them about the love of God. As a matter of fact, we are called, we are ordained, we are commanded to tell the world about the love of God. Let me tell you something. What are you showing them? What am I showing them? Because we can say, oh, we love everybody, but I want to tell you something. Our actions speak volumes. Often what we do can drown out what we say. And in the life of Joseph, you can see that Joseph had an amazing love. Now, how do you know that? An amazing love for God that he had. Well, preacher, how do you see that? Well, first of all, we know that he had an amazing love for God because of two key things that we'll talk about briefly that are known about Joseph. First of all, the Bible says that he was a man of righteousness. Verse 19 of our text says in the New King James, Joseph being a just man. In the King James, it says Joseph being a righteous man. And I want to tell you that we can see that Joseph had an amazing love for God by the lifestyle that he tried to live in living a life of being a just man and being a righteous man. Now, let me hasten to say that I understand that you can say, oh, now, wait a minute, preacher, there's none righteous, no, not one. That's what the Bible says. I understand that. But here's what I want you to understand, that when the Bible speaks about a person being a just or a righteous person, it basically is talking about a person that lived a godly lifestyle. That's the inference that is there. It's not talking about someone that lives so good God would let them go to heaven. Because they can't do that. And you can't do that. And I can't do that. It's not talking about they're righteous or they're just because they're living good enough they're going to get into heaven. No, because that's not possible. What it means is they were a person, when they're called righteous or just, it means that they had character, they had integrity, and that they lived with the help of God. They lived a godly lifestyle. Someone gave a powerful definition of what integrity really is one time. I forgot which event I heard that first, but here's what it says. Integrity is not what you say that you'll do. Integrity is not even always what you do when everybody's around. Integrity is really what you'll do or won't do when nobody else is looking. Think about that. Joseph lived a lifestyle in such a way that the scripture would say of him that he was a just man or a righteous man. The description itself in the Word of God, I believe, especially against the backdrop of the culture that Joseph lived in, it shows us that he was a man who loved God. You and I have been given a wonderful opportunity against the backdrop of the culture we now live in to show the world that we love God. How do we do that, preacher? By simply loving people that don't love us is one of the ways that we can do it. By not treating people how they treat you, but by treating people the way that you would want to be treated. There is a host of opportunity, a wealth of opportunity, if I can put it that way, especially in this day and time. As a matter of fact, I would say there's probably as much of a wealth of opportunity in my lifetime right now as there ever has been in my entire Christian life to show people that I have an amazing love for God by loving them, even if they don't vote the way I would vote, even if they don't think the way that I think, even if they don't want to come to church and worship God like I want to come to church and worship God, I'm still supposed to love them. It takes nothing special to love people that love us. It takes nothing special to love people that always want to do good things for us. But it takes something to love that person that tries to tell us that we're not needed anymore and that we're outdated today and we're a bunch of dinosaurs that just need to crawl off somewhere and die in a hole because that the world doesn't want the church, the world doesn't want God, and the world doesn't want the Bible. It takes something to still love them people. And I'm called to still love those people. And you are called to still love those people. And so I want the world to see in me, I want them to see that I love God. And one of the ways that they can see that, please get this, is by the way that I treat them. Is one of the key ways that they will see that I have a love for God. Joseph was a man, think about it, think about where he was. He was a man who apparently held up the teachings of what was expected of one who professed love for Almighty God. Are we doing that? Are we, with the help of God, upholding the teachings? And let me go back to a statement you hear me say a lot. You may not understand it. I do it for a reason. It was actually one of the most liberating things that ever happened in my life, next to getting saved itself, was when I come to understand I'm not supposed to try to uphold these teachings to earn my way into heaven, because I can't. I'm supposed to uphold these teachings so that I might grow and mature in my relationship with God and show Him that I love and appreciate all that He's done for me. Joseph apparently held up those teachings, and so it was seen in him. And we therefore know that by his reputation and testimony that he had an amazing love for God. Does the world know that about me? Does the world know that about you? Do they know by our reputation? Do they know by our testimony that we love Jesus and that we love God? Well, can I tell you that if they don't know that about me, and if they don't know that about you, then you and I need to be doing a better job. Because we need them to know by our reputation and by our testimony that we don't just say we love God, but that we really do love God. So we see that Joseph had an amazing love for God by the fact that he was a righteous or just man, and that he upheld the teachings of what he had of God's word and the teaching that was available then at that day and time, the old writings. Secondly, not only do we see it because he was a man of righteousness, we also see it because he was a man of obedience unto God. Well preacher, does my obedience matter to God? It absolutely matters to God. Well, preacher, what does my obedience show him? Well, apparently, it shows him a lot. Because let me tell you what you can read in John 14, 15. He says, this is the Lord. It'll be in red if you have a red letter edition of the words of the Lord in your Bible. Here's what John 14 and 15 says. If you love me, keep my commandments. Do you know what that is? That's another way of the Lord telling you and me directly. You know what? If you love me, then keep my commandments. That shows obedience unto my word and obedience. And by in turn by that, it's showing him that we love him. We can tell the Lord that we love him often, and we should. But is my life and your life showing the Lord that we love him? Again, I'm not trying to tell you that we need to strive for that obedience just to try to earn our way to heaven, because we can't earn our way to heaven. But we should want to walk in obedience as a way of showing the Lord, Lord, I appreciate what you've done for me. I appreciate my salvation. I appreciate that I'm on my way to heaven. So, Lord, one of the ways I get to do that is by walking in obedience. And, Lord, just as you instructed me, because I love you, I want to keep your commandments. Joseph was visited by an angel in his sleep. Verse 25 tells us again of his obedience. Here's what it says. Then Joseph, being aroused from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. Joseph had a visit from an angel in a dream, and he was given instruction and command. A long time ago, the God-man visited this world. He gave his life for me and you, and gave us the precious Holy Bible, so that through that Bible, we could hear his words, that he would command us, that he would tell us to obey and to walk obedience in. So my opportunity, one of my opportunities, of showing the Lord that I love him, is to understand the words of John's Gospel, chapter 14 and 15. Jesus' words, if you love me, keep my commandments. I would venture to say, I may be wrong, but how many of you parents out there, as you were raising your children, was there ever a time that you said to your children, well, why don't you act like you love me? Any of y'all ever said that? I bet you have. Can I ask you something? Have there been times in my life? Have there been times in your life where that our lack of obedience or our lack of spirituality or the way that we reacted or the way that we responded, could the Lord have heralded down from heaven and said, why don't you act like you love me? Because I want to tell you something. I'm not going to obey him and try to earn my way to heaven because I can't. I try so hard to drive that point home. But I will tell you this. I want my life. I want my conduct. I want my conversation. I want the thoughts and the dwellings in my mind. I want it to be in such a way that it would show him that I love him. I hope that you would desire the same thing. What Joseph was told to do was not an easy thing, especially in his culture. But you know what? He did it. What we are told to do in the scripture never is easy to do in any day and time that anybody's read it and lived in it either. But it's worth doing, and God will help us to do it if we will let him. What he was told was not an easy thing, Joseph, on this occasion. So how did he do it? In righteousness and in obedience, he obeyed and he did what God told him to do. And so in his justness, if you want to put it that way, in righteousness and in his obedience, I can look at the story of Joseph and say, you know what? This guy really had an amazing love for God. But let me tell you something else that blesses me about this almost silent character in the Christmas story. I don't just see in him an amazing love for God, but I see in Joseph the amazing love of God. I see in Joseph the amazing love of God. You can see in Joseph a picture, a type and shadow of the love of God. You can see in him a picture almost of the very one that he would be allowed to be involved in the growing up of the Savior of the world. You can see a type and shadow of the Lord Jesus and the love of the Lord Jesus. You can see it in Joseph. I want you to think that he had, if you think about it, he had plans of his own, I'm sure. Think about it. The love of God in the decision of his plans. Even before he was told of an angel of God in a dream what he was to do. In reading some time ago, I ran across these words. And one person described his pre-dream plans. Joseph's. They describe them this way, if you'll permit me to read this. And I quote, here's what they said. Heartbroken and betrayed, how should he respond? Should he publicly shame her? Should he turn her over to the authorities to be stoned? Her explanation of the pregnancy was not only unbelievable, but even blasphemous. If Mary would not have been stoned on the charge of adultery, she could have been stoned on the charge of serious blasphemy. However, Joseph chooses the path of mercy. He was a righteous man and unwilling to put her to shame. So he resolved to divorce her quietly. That was his pre-dream plans. But now listen, before any divine explanation, Joseph already chose mercy. No malice, no explosion, no going on no Hollywood TV show. Certainly, he could have asked a lot of questions here. How could you have done this to me? Who's the father? But no words like that are recorded of Joseph. Only tenderness. talk of Nazareth. Friends might make snide comments, but he would not hurt Mary. No matter what he thought she had done to him, what he could have demanded was a bitter sentence. But he chose a righteous mercy. Can I ask you today, do you hear any ring of familiarity in that choice of Joseph? Can you hear any ring of familiarity in that same kind of choice? In someone making that kind of choice for you? Well, you should, because I can. Does it sound familiar? Someone that came to you and that offered grace and mercy to an individual, speaking about me and you, who based on culture and based on religion, what we should have got was not, certainly wouldn't have been grace, and certainly wouldn't have been mercy. And just in case that you have forgotten, and just in case we all may forget sometimes, let me remind you of some others who were found in a similar situation as Mary, as far as what thought she had done could have demanded harsh penalties. You can find one of those reminders in the book of Romans, chapter 3 and 23, where it says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." That's us. Did you hear me? That's us. Every one of us. Now, I know I'm probably the only person that's ever run into any church folk like this, but through the years, I just hate to tell you, I've run across a few church folk that they seem to think they were born saved, sanctified, baptized in the Holy Ghost on their way to heaven. Well, they don't think nobody's ever lived for God like them. I've met a few of them folk, and I want to tell you something. They were absolutely wrong. Truth be told, in years gone by, certainly not over in this county, of course, but truth be told, I even tried to pastor a few people like that. If they would admit it, we listen, Brother Long had it well. But it's not true. That's why that if I ever see somebody that's living a life of just terrible, ugly sin, and they're angry all the time, and they just look for ways to just take advantage, and they look for ways to mistreat. You know, that old human nature sometimes would like to look and say, how dare they have the audacity to be such a way? But a better thing would be for me to look at and say, you know what? There was a time. Circumstances might have been different. I was just as bad, just as lost, and just as lonely. Not me, preacher. I never would treat my wife like I know somebody treated theirs. Maybe not. But how did you treat that boss that you worked for? How did you treat that mom and daddy that raised you? Did you always treat them like they should have been treated? What about that grandma and granddad in your life? Did you always treat them right? Did you always do the right thing? Did you always say the right thing? Did you always think the right thing? Well, I don't even have to talk to you to answer that. No, you didn't. And I didn't. You want to know why I know? I just read you why I know. Because all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. You see, there was a day that I was just as much in need of grace and mercy as Mary was when Joseph found out the situation that she had found herself in. I know that all of us need this love like Joseph had, that was a type of the love of God. And you want to know something else that adds to the case? You can turn to Romans 6 and 23 to find out why everybody that's named in Romans 3 and 23, Romans 6 and 23 tells me that they need grace and mercy. Because Romans 6, 23 says, "For the wages of sin is death." I thank God that that verse didn't stop right there? Do you know how fortunate we are that there's not a period right there where it says, for the wages of sin is death? Do you understand that a period not being right there where I stop reading is another picture of the amazing love of God Almighty? Because the next word says, but. It's one of the greatest transitions of the Bible. But the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus, our Lord. If there had been a period behind for the wages of sin is death, you'd be on your way to hell, and I'd be on my way to hell. If that's all that the verse said, if that's where it ended. But thank God it was not a period there. Thank God that transition said, but the gift of God is eternal life. Who would that eternal life come through? Just one. And his name is Jesus Christ. You see, I can see in Joseph an amazing love for God that he had. And I'm so glad that he did. But I can also see in Joseph the amazing love of God. For even Joseph's pre-dream plans, he chose mercy. He could have said, have y'all heard what this woman's done to me? I won't let my name be dragged through the mud. Stone her! Because do you understand that that's what religion, by the letter of the law, that's what it would have demanded of her, just on the suspicion? But if they had said, okay, we don't have the proof, just because of her explanation of how she ended up where she did, they still could have, by the rule of law, they could have stoned her for blasphemy. Do you remember today, do I remember today, that if we got what we deserved, it would not be grace, would not be mercy, but it would be an assignment and consignment to the eternal pits of hell for all eternity, because all have sinned and all have fallen short of the glory of God. From the silent character of the Nativity, we find someone who, in my opinion, humble as it may be, who has spoken volumes to us through his actions. He showed us an amazing love for God through his righteousness or justice and through his obedience. He shows us the amazing love of God through mercy and grace. It is my prayer that every one of you has experienced this love like Joseph's love, as it was a type of the love that you and I experience by coming to know Christ as our personal Savior. If not, I'm reminded of that old song that says, there is room at the cross for you. There's never a bad time to get saved, but certainly one of the most special times of the year to come to know Christ, I believe, would have to be the Christmas season. And so I would say, Brother Keith, would you please come to the keyboard? I would say to you today, for each one of us who have experienced this grace and mercy firsthand, we've accepted Christ as our Savior and repented of our sins. I would like to just challenge you that I hope that through this Advent series, we've been able to challenge you along these lines. I hope it's challenged you to keep the wonderful hope of Isaiah. This world is in desperate need of hope. And we know who hope is. His name is Jesus. I hope that it has reminded you that we can know the kind of peace that the angels pleaded for. We've tried in this world to find peace so many different ways. We're told that there's nations coming online for peace deals in the next few weeks and months. but it still will not accomplish the kind of peace that is found in the heart of a man or woman when they come to know Jesus as their personal Savior. I hope that it challenges you to keep sharing the joy that the shepherds announced, saying, they heralded that. I grew up, I'm so old, I grew up singing that song, I've got the joy, 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 joy down in my soul. Any of y'all remember that? Can I ask you something? Is the joy, 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 joy down in your soul being shared with the world? And is it being shown? I hope this series has brought some remembrances to you that we've got to keep sharing the hope. We've got to keep having the experience of peace and sharing the peace and the hope of peace with others. And we've got to walk in that joy in the Holy Spirit and share it with others. And it is part of my assignment. It is part of your assignment. Let me make it a little stronger. It is a part of the command that is given to you and I to show the love of God to a lost and a dying world. You could be like Joseph. Preacher, you just don't know what that man done to me. You gotta love him. You just don't know what that woman did. You gotta love him. You gotta love him anyway. You're commanded, I'm commanded to show the love of God. And not just in December, but all year long. All year long, let's share the hope. Let's share the peace. Let's share the joy. Let's share the love every day of the year. Will you bow your heads, please? On this wonderful rainy Sunday morning that I am so glad that you came to join us. As every head is bowed and every eye is closed, I just want to remind you today that if there's one person here that's not yet experienced the joy, peace, the hope, the love that we've been talking about in this series, you can. You just need to come to know Christ as your Savior. So just so I can go home with a clear conscience, if there's anyone here today that would say by an uplifted hand, preacher, I've never accepted Christ as my Savior, would you just lift that hand so I know how to pray for you? I won't embarrass you or single you out. Just let me know how to pray. Or if there's one that would say right now, I know what it once was to be walking with the Savior, but I've drifted away and I need a recommitting of my life to Jesus. I need to renew my first love with the Master. I need to rededicate my life to Him. Is there anyone at all that would say by that lifted hand, pray for me because that's what's needed in my life. Just lift it up, slip it back down so I don't have to pray. God knows our hearts. Praise the name of Jesus. Will you stand with me, please? I hope you'll all be back tonight. It's not going to be a very lengthy service at all. Just in case one or two of you don't make it back tonight, not sure if you will. Let me say on behalf of my lovely bride and myself, Diane and I, let me say Merry Christmas to you. We love you and we appreciate you. You're so grateful and so thankful for all that the Shiloh family does for our family. I'm not trying to sound melodramatic. I mean this from my heart. And I don't want you to think I ever forget this. I understand that every time my wife and I get to go to a grocery store and carry groceries back home, you have a part of that. Every time that PNC gets a house payment so I can stay 30 more days, you have a part of that. You know what? Because of how graciously and wonderfully you provide for our family. Please don't ever think that we forget it. I love you. I pray that the Christ child of Christmas would just fill your home with His love and His peace. And from Diane and I, Merry Christmas. We love you and we appreciate you. Now, I can't do what I would like to do with you. conclusion of this service. So don't anybody do this, because what I'd like to do is say no dismissal prayer. Just shake some hands and hug some necks. I'll be so glad when we can get back to that normalcy. Can I get a witness? So today, instead of a dismissal prayer, I'm just going to give you opportunity to maybe turn and just wave at some folks, or maybe kind of do these virtual hugs I think I've seen. I want you to know I love you and I appreciate you. Merry Christmas to you all. I hope you'll be back tonight as we share just a few more moments tonight together before Christmas. God bless you. You're dismissed. We appreciate you and we love you.